السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين، ونصلي ونسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين، نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن سلك طريقهم وسار على نهجهم ودعا بدعوتهم إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، we commence by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless his whole household, and at the same time all his companions and all those who struggled and strove through the years to learn the deen, to put it into practice, to convey it in a way that it has come to us today. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every single one of us and grant us goodness. Before we proceed, brothers, I'd like to request that we move forward, for indeed to leave gaps would not be the quality of the mu'mineen when they are sitting to listen to a form of a dhikr and a remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the statement I have made moments ago and how we normally start most of the lectures and most of the Islamic durus and lessons, where we send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and thereafter we include those who struggled and strove through the generations in a way that today the deen came to me and you. My concern and yours should be to work our way into that statement in a way that tomorrow, when our children or grandchildren or the people of the ummah to come start their own lessons or their lectures, and they also commence by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions, and then they make mention of all those who struggled and strove through the years to bring the deen to us, we would be from amongst that chain. So this evening I want to spend a few moments on this particular subject. How is it that we can work our way to finding our names or ourselves included in that dua? What a blessed dua. Imagine we say, وَمَن تَبِعَهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ إِلَىٰ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ. Those who have followed them with goodness up to the end of time. May Allah make us and our offspring from amongst them. Yes, we are so fortunate to be Muslimin. We thank Allah. We utter the shahada. We thank Allah. Every one of us should be grateful to Allah that we have this shahada on our tongues. أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. I bear witness that there is none worthy of worship besides Allah. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger, the final prophet, the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That statement is more heavy on the scale than 99 files of bad deeds, each one from the east to the west, filled with bad deeds. And if you were to put that La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah on the other side of the scale, it would be heavier. So aren't we lucky? Aren't we fortunate? Wallahi, we are very fortunate. We should thank Allah. We should praise Allah. We should really be happy. Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. Allah has chosen myself and yourselves to be from this ummah. May He keep it that way, and may He make us genuinely from the ummah. So we have a lot to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. My brothers and sisters, never feel for a moment that Allah has forsaken you. We go through difficulties in our lives. We go through issues, whether they are marital, whether they are social, whether they are economical. No matter what type of difficulties we go through, my brothers and sisters, that is all by the way. It is a minor issue. It is something small. It is something minute in comparison to the gift of Allah upon us. People become despondent and they start saying, Allah has let me down, I have a sickness. May Allah cure all those who are sick and ill. If sometimes people say, I have a sickness and I'm not getting cured, I have a disease, I have cancer, I have this, I have arthritis, I have a back, a problem, I have you know, any other problem, subhanAllah, all that is minute. Allah's gift upon you eclipses the little tests that you are going through. If you know the value of the shahada you have, that is the test. Allah is holding you and Allah is granting you something far greater than the dunya has. Even if they are healthy, wealthy, and if they've got everything on their plate. If they don't have the shahada, they've got zero. They've got nothing. So don't lose this. But at the same time, it is your duty and mine to learn what this means, to learn the deen, to put it into practice, and to go out of our way to convey the message. Conveying the message firstly to yourself. You need to convey it from your tongue to your organs. So you know the message, it's in your brain, it's in your mind, it's in your heart. Now translate it. Start conveying it to your hands and to your feet. You must not only speak like a Muslim, but you must live like a Muslim. You must walk like a Muslim. You must, your day-to-day interactions must be like a Muslim. And this is when you will have conveyed the message to yourself to start with. And thereafter, the conveying of that message should be to your own family members. As we know, the Quran has stated this very clearly. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ. O you who believe, save yourselves and your family members from the fire. The fire whose fuel shall be stones and men. Imagine men mixed with red hot stones. Or should I say human beings mixed with red hot stones. One cannot imagine that. When you have a braai or a barbecue, the chicken or the beef that you are braaiing, what happens to it? You put it at a distance from the fire in order for it to be cooked. What if you were to put it in the coal itself? You will not be able to eat it. It will burn. So imagine if human being would be roasted in not only the coal that we know, but red hot stones. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. So it's our duty to save ourselves and to save our family members to start with. Try your best with them by leading by example, number one. When you lead by example, it's far easier for them to follow. If you are dressed in an unacceptable way, don't expect your daughters to dress any better. If you are a man who is fiddling with his phone, with wrong relations, don't expect your children to do any better. By the will of Allah and His mercy, they may. But you don't expect that because it was your duty to lead by example and you didn't. May Allah forgive us and forgive our shortcomings. So you want to dress in a specific way, you want to speak in a specific manner. Like we say, if you want to act like a hooligan in the presence of your children, they will be bigger hooligans than you. May Allah protect myself and yourself. It's important for us to realize this. Passing the message across is not done by being hypocritical, but it is done by being genuine and sincere. This is why we say, you have a weakness, you need to acknowledge your weakness and work on it. You don't need to pretend to be the Pope where you have all the weaknesses and you are busy pointing fingers at the rest. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and may He make us really from those who can convey a message in a way that we will benefit from it to start with. And this is why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about those who remind others, forgetting themselves, He asks the question, أَتَأْمُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْبِرِّ وَتَنْسَوْنَ أَنفُسَكُمْ. Are you ordering or instructing or encouraging people to be righteous when you are forgetting yourselves? And He doesn't end there. He says, وَأَنْتُمْ تَتْلُونَ الْكِتَابَ. Yet you are the ones who are reading Revelation. We know, I may know something, I've learnt it, and I'm instructing others to do it, but I'm not doing it myself. So Allah says, you know the Revelation, you're teaching it to others, and you're not doing anything about it yourself. So then He ends by saying, أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Do you not have any sense? Do you not have any brains? Do you not have that thinking capacity? Don't you think? What is it you are doing? May Allah strengthen us. My duty to work on myself, then to work on those around me. When I've tried my best, then the circle broadens. I need to work on as many people as I can amongst the Muslimin and then also amongst the non-Muslims. And this is why we say, my brothers and sisters, Islam is powerful enough to be spread without your assistance or mine. Remember that. Allah's word is solid enough, and His ayat and signs across the globe and across creation are enough and more powerful than anything I could do or you could do. To spread Islam, Allah does not need me or you. But the worry is how many people are dejected or how many people are deterred from Islam because of me or you. That's the worry. The worry is not how many entered Islam because of me and you. Allah does not need me or you. If someone has entered because of me or you, it's a bonus. It is some gift of Allah. But Allah does not count on me or you to spread His deen. But He will definitely hold it against me or you if we have been the reason for a deterrent for someone to have entered Islam. Remember this. So this is why we say, as Muslimin, it is of utmost importance that we carry ourselves as Muslims. That on its own will invite people to the goodness of Islam, if not bring them straight into the religion. What this means is, there are sometimes enemies of Islam who don't like Islam. They hate it. They don't want to hear about it. But Allah makes them be stuck with their vehicle on the N2, for example. And who happens to come along? Yourself. It is your opportunity to showcase Islam. Not because we want to do it to show them. But we just want to be real Muslims. A proper Muslim. And as a result, the minimum that will happen, they will realize this is a religion. These people are okay. That's what they will realize. Minimum. We're talking here of minimum. The word okay means they're all right. An enemy of Islam to acknowledge that you are okay, it means my enmity is cracked. That itself is down. Allahu Akbar. We have called people to Islam through the goodness of practicing alone. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Look at Islam spreading across the globe. If you look at how it spread in Far East Asia and various other countries, I'm sure you've heard of it. It was through the upright dealings of the business people who went there to trade. They went there to trade, but their trading was so upright that the people began to ask the question, what is it with these people? They are so upright. Something is holding them, protecting them from stealing, cheating, deceiving. What is it? It is their faith. So we belong to the faith. How many of us have been an insult to Islam? Let's ask ourselves. An insult to our own faith, where we do not practice it. We speak in a way that is far from the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Every other word we use is a swear word. Within our homes, within the community, within society, within the Muslims, within the non-Muslims. Everything we do, subhanallah, does not reflect that which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. Then what gift do we appreciate in terms of the shahada? I want to word it very, very strongly this evening for myself to begin with and then for yourselves. How do we want to word it? I have chosen to go back to the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was all alone. And Jibreel alayhi salam came to him. And Jibreel alayhi salam read the first verses of Revelation. Iqara. He was honest enough to say, Ma ana biqari. I am not a reader. And it repeated itself, and the story continues until he received that first part of Revelation. What did he do? He ran down the mount. And he came to his wife Khadija binti Khuwaylid radiallahu anha. We all know this very, very well. What did he say to her? He said, Zammiluni. We know this. Zammiluni. Cover me. Cover me. And immediately she covered him. And she supported him. And she accepted the message right at the beginning. The first one. She knew, this is my husband. He is such an honest man. Such an upright man. That no matter what he says, I know he's telling the truth. How many of us, for a mobile phone, our wives don't believe us? Who sent you that message? And she will not believe you, come what may. You have saved Fatima's number as Maulana so and so. Why? Because you want to deceive. This is why our families do not take deen from us. That's the point. Because we have deceived ourselves. This man came with something nobody would believe in a rush. Unless they knew the man and they knew that he was an honest man. So the first people to accept were those who understood that and realized it. Because he lived his life that way. How many of us are ready to understand this? I've given you a living example of a mobile phone. We're not ready to be trusted with our own mobile phones. A message beeps at 2 in the morning, beep beep.
And we are so quick to react to it that we give it away. No matter how long your beard is, my brother, you've given it away. Allahu Akbar. Now when you tell your wife something, I'm going for salah, she will think 250 times you have penalized her, you have punished her. Yet when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came and said, an angel came to me, and he told me, Iqra, and he said this, she said, Kalla wallahi la yukhzika Allahu abadan. Never will Allah let you down. It is the truth. I believe in it. You are an honest man. You have always been honest. You are a person who looks after the neighbors for the pleasure of the Maker. For nothing in return. You are a person who looks after the weak and downtrodden. You go out. You are kind to everyone. These are characters, conduct. This is what spread Islam. His character immediately was picked up by his wife. What happened when he came back from Mi'raj? When they told Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, what do you think of a man who says, listen to how difficult it is for a person who does not know the man to believe the story. If you tell your wife at 10 at night to say, I'm with my friends eating somewhere out, she will start doubting. 50 doubts going through her head. You're sitting at 2 in the morning on a computer saying, no, pornography is out of the picture here. And she is coming and checking and you quickly closing the windows there. And this is what's happening. Look, those things are far. They are happening in our lives. With Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, take a look at what occurred. They ask Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, what do you think of a person who says that he has gone from here to Baytul Maqdis by night, and the same night he's taken up from there to the seven heavens, and the same night he comes back, and the same night he comes back to Makkatul Mukarrama, and thereafter he is in his bedding before the morning. So obviously, this is, he's not told who it is or what it is. One of the riwayat make mention that he said that is not possible. So they said, your friend said that that's what happened. Immediately he said, if he said it, then wallahi it has happened. Subhanallah. Something impossible. And this is not a wife, or it's not a brother, or it's not a father or a son. It is a friend. How many of our friends can believe us? This is why the deen is not progressing from our mouths and our tongues. Allah is using other means to progress the deen. We are not truthful to ourselves. Truthfulness is a quality that you definitely need to lead a happy life and to be able to spread the deen, not even by telling a person, please enter Islam, but by your uprightness. Subhanallah. Person walks into your business, they have given you 1,000 rands more, and they were so happy they walked out with a good deal for you to stand up as a Muslim, my brother. Obviously, brother, if he's not a Muslim, he probably would just be a human being who's a brother in humanity. So you say, listen, my brother, there is 1,000 rands more that you have given me. I believe there are still Muslims who do that. May Allah make me and you from amongst those. What's the point of returning his 1,000 rands when the sin we are committing back at home is worth 1,000,000 rands deducted from the account? We are already overdraft. Allahu Akbar. There, we earn something. But at home, we're not as honest. Charity begins at home. Remember that. A true person is known by his relation with his family members. Don't be deceived. You are known by the relation with your family members. خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. The best from amongst you are those who are best to their spouses, their family members. The term ahl includes a lot in it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. May He open our thinking. So, I've given you an example of Khadija binti Khuwaylid radiallahu anha. She immediately stood up in support of this man. And she said, this is my husband. I've known him for just a few years, these 15 years. And I know you are not a liar. You will not cheat. You will not deceive. You will not harm. You will not this. You will not that. Allah will never let you down. Here you are. I am with you. I take you to my uncle. Let him explain. And the story continues. And I've given you an example of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Subhanallah. They are like that. So many examples. But there is something bigger. Something bigger. Do you know, today the deen got to you and to me, my brothers and my sisters in Islam. This religion has got to you and to me because of Allah's fadl and mercy. And because of the sacrifice of certain people. Who are these people? Do you want to realize, today we are not ready to give up a cigarette until the doctor tells us, you are now dying. Then you say, okay, now throw it out. When the doctor tells you you've had a heart attack, throw this bad habit, then you throw it out. But when you are harming an amana that Allah lent you for a little while, this body is not going to be with you for long. Your body is your uniform for your test. When you go to a school, you wear a uniform, you have your test, you come out of the school, remove the uniform, leave it there and you carry on. This body is there as a uniform for your soul's test. Your soul is tested, so Allah puts it into a body, brings it on the earth, you will remove the uniform and your soul will carry on. That's what you need to understand. So this body, when you treat it in a way that it's not supposed to be treated, your uniform is wrong. This is why I dress properly. Don't be frightened of your Islamic identity. My sisters, remember, your uniform is going to be taken off one day. When your soul goes off, leaving that body on the earth, Allah says, مِنْهَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ وَفِيهَا نُعِيدُكُمْ وَمِنْهَا نُخْرِجُكُمْ تَارَةً أُخْرَى. We have created you from the soil. We will return you back into the same soil, the earth, and we will resurrect you therefrom once again. May Allah grant us goodness. So this sacrifice, we need to realize we are not prepared to give up a cigarette. I'm honest. Obviously, people are now debating, is it makruh, is it haram? My brothers, my sisters, don't fool yourself. Is it harmful or not? The answer is yes, it is. Last week, I was in UK. And believe me, I saw cigarettes. Not only expensive, but every box says two words. Smoking kills. That is the message. And I was talking to one of the ulama and he was saying, this particular issue of smoking kills and how it is illegal to sell a box of cigarettes without writing on it, smoking kills. And then he said something very interesting. He said, you know, when the law came out that you are not allowed to sell cigarettes unless you write smoking kills or is harmful to you on the box, all the tobacco companies immediately signed up and agreed. And they said, we'll write it in big. Why? They are so confident of their product that no matter how much we tell these people, you will die. They say, no problem, I take the puff. Wallahi, look at that. Have you thought of it that way? They are so confident of their product. Who will tell you, brother, you are dying if you enter here, there are lions. And you say, no problem, I'll go inside. They wouldn't do that. The zoo won't tell you, you know, it's like bungee jumping in Zimbabwe. They won't tell you, look, you can jump for free, no strings attached. Nobody would go. But at the same time, we Muslims, we see them writing smoking kills and we say, no problem, we're going. They were so confident that they've got us nailed. That's what it is. They've got us nailed. They don't mind. Even if they write to you, smoke 5, you die instantly. We'll smoke 4.5, 4 3/4. And we leave that little quarter. May Allah safeguard us. Is this what? We cannot sacrifice a cigarette. How many of us are ready to throw it out? People died for you. That's why the deen is here today. Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib was murdered because of you. And you cannot give up a cigarette. Allahu Akbar. Mus'ab ibn Umayr radiallahu anhu was murdered because of you. And you cannot cover your hair, my sister. If they did not fight, where would we be today? Name them. Name all of them. 313 people. They said, Ya Allah, we are ready to give our lives. That's when the deen came to me and you. I cannot give up adultery. They gave up their lives. Nobody's asking you to kill yourself. Allah is only asking you one thing. Give up your bad habits. Turn to me. They gave their lives for you. Wallahi, they died. They were murdered in cold blood. They went, go and see what happened to them. And I cannot give up pornography. What a silly habit. Where is it going to get me? What is it? I cannot cover myself for the sake of Allah. And then I want to say that no, I am happy to be an ummati of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Think about this. It is by far the most powerful question you will ask yourself. Nobody is asking you to die right now and right here. Allah is asking you to serve Him, to worship Him alone, to practice the deen, to put it into practice, to convey it to others, to be kind to others, to be honest, to be trustworthy. We steal from people, we cheat them, we con them, we deceive them, and yet There were people who wallahi have died in their hundreds and thousands for the deen to come to me today. And I don't realize I am enjoying the shahada because of the martyrdom of so many people. Name them when you read a sahaba's name. Any one of the sahaba, when you read their names, ask yourself, this man was martyred because of me. The deen came to me today. What am I doing? I can't even sacrifice for the sake of Allah to get up for Salatul Fajr. Is that the deen? Are you going to die by getting up for Salah? No, you're not. We go to Mecca. We go to Medina Munawwara. We make salam. We go to Baqi'. We greet. And we know. We go to Uhud. We see. We feel. The hair stands. Is that where it stops? Think for a moment. Wallahi, they fought with their swords. The enemy came to swipe. They stood so that those who remained carried the deen. Today, it is here in Port Elizabeth. Strong, live and kicking. Why? Because of the sacrifice that is made. If you are not ready to make a sacrifice, who knows, the deen may be taken away from yourselves and your progeny. And Allah says it in the Quran, very, very loud and clear. It is so scary. But we need to word it to ourselves firstly and remind ourselves.
Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu man yartadda minkum an dini fasawfa ya'ti Allahu biqaumin yuhibbuhum wa yuhibbuna adhillatin 'alal mu'minin 'izzatin 'alal kafirin.
Allahu Akbar. What powerful verses they are. Allah says, O you who believe, whoever from amongst you turns away from your deen, so Allah will bring forth other people. Allah will bring forth a nation, a group of people who will love him and who will love them. Meaning, who will love Allah and Allah will love them. And they will be humble when it comes to the mu'mineen. And they will be strengthened against the kuffar. Subhanallah. They will be solid. Not like us, weaklings. Allahu Akbar. So weak that we can pump weights of 100 kilos and boast to the rest of the people in the gym. But that same set of biceps cannot lift your blanket up for Salatul Fajr. Where are we? What are we doing? Why are we deceived? We cannot sacrifice. So this is it. We need to constantly ask ourselves, what have I done? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he will recognize us on the how. How will he recognize us? Am I a follower of his? Have I read Salah? Do I even know his companions, what they did for me, so that the deen came to me? How many of us know about our sahaba radiallahu anhum? Today, it is so easy. You can turn on whilst you are walking, whilst you are driving or riding or even walking, you can have an iPod or you can have a little CD or you can perhaps turn on the radio and listen to something constructive. Perhaps you may be able to listen to something, or even if you come to the masjid and you are able to sit in the programs, you will be able to learn a lot about the sacrifices of those. And you will be able to understand how fortunate you are that today we are busy sitting and eating the fruits of their sacrifice. Ask the countries like this one here that have been colonized in the past, what type of struggle they went through. Today, people don't even know the struggle of the freedom fighters of a long time ago, when they couldn't even live, when they were jailed. Whatever happened to them happened. That is in the near past. What about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? They offered him women, he declined them. They offered him wealth, he declined it. They offered him position, he declined it. Why? So the deen came to me and you. That's why. Because if he accepted any one of those things, it would have stopped there and then. This was the limit of it. He said, no, the broader picture, the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we are a part of them. Look at it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our eyes. That's all that is needed. Open our eyes and see. This dunya around us is a deception. They sacrificed. Some of them passed away at a very early age. Some of them martyred in the first few battles. Some of them took part in so many battles in order to save the deen. Look at what happened during Khandaq, subhanallah. The large numbers of people that came, the alliances that came to Medina Munawwara, they thought that we will walk straight through Medina and it's going to be the end. The hypocrites were such that they on that day they said, now there is no hope for these people. And yet Allah's help came. And Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu presented an opinion to dig the trench. I want to tell you something. And this is now looking at the seerah from a different perspective. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are the ahadith and narrations that make mention of how he dug with his own hands part of the trench. Why? For you, for me. Do you know that? He dug with his own hands. Hunger, no food, all the Sahaba trying to meet a deadline, one after the other. One thought he was hungry, the other thought he was hungry, and carrying on. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had two stones tied on his belly, two of them, and he just carried on. Yet he was afdalul khalqi wa akramur rusuli, the best of creation, the most honored of all messengers. What happened? He was digging. They dug so deep, so wide. When the enemy came, there was no way to cut across. So the deen, by the will of Allah, through the plan of Allah, preserved with a sacrifice. Now the question is, if Allah wanted, the deen could have been preserved without a sacrifice. If Allah wanted, no battle would have taken place. Whoever intended harm, Allah could have wiped them out without a battle. If Allah wanted, there would have been no martyrs. Have you ever asked yourself, why did Allah allow this to happen, where a sacrifice was needed in order for the deen to continue? Simple reason: to differentiate between the truthful and the liars. That's the only thing.
أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ.
Allah says, do people think it's enough for them to say we are believers and then they are not tested? Allah says, they were tested even before in order for us to distinguish who are the truthful and who are the liars. So the tests will come. They came to them. A sacrifice is required. And that is what will make you earn the reward that you deserve. When you put in sacrifice, the more the sacrifice, the greater the reward. So the hadith goes. The hadith says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا إِبْتَلَاهُ. When Allah loves someone, He puts more tests in his life. He tests him. And the hadith says, عِظَمُ الْأَجْرِ مَعَ عِظَمِ الْإِبْتِلَاهُ. The greater the reward, or the greater reward is with the greater test. The greater test. The greater sacrifice. You are ready to sacrifice for Allah, Allah will test you. You sacrifice more, Allah will reward you. When Allah rewards you, you will see the more you have in terms of test, the more opportunities you have to gain closeness to Allah. Don't become depressed because you are sick, because you suffered a loss in business, because you lost your wife, you lost your husband, you lost a child or a parent or a brother or a sister. Allah grant us all Jannah. Ultimately, we all have to go. If you become depressed at that, you have lost focus of the fact that that was an opportunity for you to gain even more closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. May Allah open our doors, grant us goodness. I always say that when we are asked to fulfill our farad, yes, we should fulfill it. But that is a duty. Allah has given us so much. Allah has given us our eyes, our noses, the air we are breathing and so on, the heartbeat of how many thousands a day.
how many thousands in terms of the heartbeat a day. No battery, no Duracell, no ever ready, no. It just continues by the will of Allah. How many thousands? You don't even know. And we owe Allah the fara'id. Like we say, if Allah has given you wealth, the 2.5% or whatever percentage it is that you need to work out in order to give as zakat, that's not your wealth. That is actually Allah's. You only have to give it to Him. You're holding it temporarily. And you've given it. So you fulfilled a farad. Your real test is to go beyond that. That is now from you. It's from your pocket. The other part was not from your pocket. It was just Allah's due, which you only as an amana put it aside and gave it where He wanted you. He instructed you to give it tamlikan to the poor people, and it went. Now the test is yours beyond that. So we say, the farad, you come for your 5 salah. Yes, alhamdulillah. But that is a duty unto Allah. You got to engage in sunnah and nafil. That is yours. Now that is yours. You are doing that because you want to do it. Very big difference. You are reading salah because you have to, you stop at your farad. You are reading it because you want to, you continue further and you improve your farad. Subhanallah. Same applies to your dress code. May Allah make it easy for us to dress appropriately, both male and female. Before, we used to only conquer the women to say, you know, you must cover your hair, you mustn't dress with tight clothing. Today, we have to conquer the men even more. They dress with tight clothing and they still think, we are men. Our aura is not. Wallahi, my brother, those jeans you are wearing, those skinny jeans are unacceptable. Wallahi. If people died for you, come on, give up your jeans at least. At least make them wider, broader. Come on. Cover your backside, my brother. Wallahi, it's a fact. We are suffering on the globe. Wallahi, we are suffering. And what I'm talking about is not unknown to us. We know exactly what it is. We are suffering with it because we are affected by it. We are struggling. You need to be a Muslim in totality. What can you do for Islam? What are you ready to do so that at least your children can see that my father is a good Muslim? He always dressed in a specific way. He always read Quran. Some of us have had parents and older people of the other generation which we know. With their good qualities, this man used to come every Friday in the masjid early in the morning and he used to sit in the corner and read Quran right up to the time of salah. Where are those people? One day it will have to be me and you. May Allah make it us. It's no good saying, oh, the old man, we're going to miss him. He used to come every day early. You're going to miss him. Another 10 should get up and start doing that. Subhanallah. Learn from his example. There are so many people who close their businesses early. They come. So what are you ready to do, my sister? Are you ready to do something for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that your own family and your home can have ronak in it? It can have the nur and the light in it. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. May He grant us ease. So as we said, Allah is instructing us to save ourselves, to save our family members, to convey the message, to continue further. But without a sacrifice, nothing will happen. And when we say sacrifice, it is not easy. Allah will put it in your path. And you need a sacrifice in order to stand up for the sake of Allah. Let me give you a few live examples. Current. To abstain from a sin is a duty of a Muslim. We all agree. But do you realize without accessibility to that sin, you are not accepted to engage in that act of worship? I don't know if you understood what I said. Let me repeat it. If I were to tell you, brother, not to drink alcohol and to protect yourself from drinking alcohol is your duty as a Muslim, and it is an ibadah to save yourself from drinking alcohol. If alcohol is never available and not there and it's something nowhere near, then you haven't achieved the opportunity to engage in abstaining from something accessible because it's not accessible. But the minute it's flashing around you, you've come across it, your reward is greater because something that was close at hand and it was easily holdable and doable, I did not do it. Why? Because I fear Allah. Can give you another more live example. If a person lives in an environment where everybody is dressing Islamically, say all the women are in hijab, and it would be out of place not to wear the hijab, Then mashallah, you are being given a gift of Allah that you will have to wear the hijab because of the fact that you feel I'm going to look out of place. So now when people go to a janazah, they wear their hijab. When people go to a madrasa, they wear their hijab because they don't want to feel out of place. Some example. But when you have gone to such a place and you still have not worn your hijab and you have not minded being a person who's totally out of place in the wrong way, then only Allah knows what is the condition of your heart. And that I'm wording it very, very diplomatically. And on the flip side, if you are a person who is living in a hostile environment where nobody is doing the right thing and you are the only one dressed properly, then you have a double, triple, quadruple, 10 times reward, perhaps up to 700 times. Because then it was so easy and easier for you not to dress properly because it was so acceptable in society to be dressing in the wrong way. But I was given the opportunity by Allah to do it properly and I did it. Now you are speaking. Now you have really abstained from haram for the sake of Allah. Adultery. If it is something that is far and you are busy working hard to achieve it, wallahi, you are very, very sinful. But if it is something accessible, close to you, and you are still staying away from it, now you are speaking. Now you are speaking. Now you deserve a reward. Why? Because now you have really abstained from a sin for the sake of Allah. Something accessible. This is why, if you look at the hadith known as hadith al-sab'ah, the hadith of the seven people who will be granted a special shade on the day of Qiyamah, one of them is رَجُلٌ دَعَتْهُ إِمْرَأَةٌ ذَاتُ مَنْصَبٍ وَجَمَالٍ فَقَالَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ. A person whom adultery was made so accessible to, that this a woman or a person of the opposite sex is calling them, they are of a high standard, they are very good looking, they have high status and wealth, the privacy is there, everything is set. And this person comes up and says, I fear Allah, and walks away. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. I fear Allah, and they walk away. Allah says, you are a VIP. You have now done something for the pleasure of your maker. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Imagine when I sat and read this hadith, and we've read it many, many times, for many, many years. Each time you sit, something comes into your mind, and your heart, and something trembles inside you, when you start thinking, Ya Ilaha Al-Alameen, O Allah. Here you have mentioned a special shade of the day of Qiyamah for a person who did this once for your sake. Allah didn't say twice, thrice, four times. Obviously, once meaning you will abstain from the sin thereafter. Nobody is saying you can do it 20 times, but only once you must stay away. No, but Allah mentions it once alone. And that would be enough to wipe out everything that happened in the past. You engage in tawbah. Now you've done it for the pleasure of Allah. Allah says, come, you deserve the shade of this day of Qiyamah. Imagine. Why? Because the sin was accessible and we stayed away from it. Now look at the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. What was their lives full of? What were their lives full of? Full of sacrifice. But what type of sacrifice? That we got to look into. Because the type of sacrifice they engaged in today, for us, we don't even consider it as something because we've never even been through. They didn't have food for how many years? 3 years, according to some narrations, in Shi'ab Abi Talib. 3 years, sanctions. And it was so easy for them to break it and to go and get a quick chow, as we would call it. Go and get a quick chow and come back. It was so easy. They didn't. They had that unity of purpose. You know what? They died. But they did not compromise the deen. Today, halal, haram, we're ready to compromise. People are telling you, look, you have this option, and you have that option, and you have this option. Wallahi, if there is something doubtful, my brothers, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, forget about doubtful. Halal also, they stayed away from it. Halal. Because they were forced to at times. And at times, they did not want to indulge. Because they didn't want to get so pleasurable in the dunya that they forget the akhirah. This was a quality. We have to talk about it. It does not mean we are telling people to divorce themselves from the dunya. But just to wake us up to see where we are and why we are where we are. And the sacrifice of those people. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam being the best of creation. Imagine, you and I know what happened in Taif. And you know how the mountains were also ready to get together by the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The angels of the mounts had come and said, we can crush these people. You know what happened. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was so powerful that the mountains were ready to obey. Aisha radiallahu anha says, sometimes we saw the moon and we saw the moon and we saw the moon, which means 3 months passed by and we had not yet lit a stove in this house. Because there was nothing besides tamru wal ma, water and dates. I ask you, billahi alaykum, I ask you by the name of Allah, how many of us have ever lived on water and dates for 1 month? Only water and dates for a month. And we are nowhere near best of creation. I think wives would leave their husbands and apply for nullifications immediately. Hey, this house has only water and dates, nothing else. It's a fact. No, this man is not providing. And the best of creation, the best of creation, his wives were so delighted to be his wives, subhanAllah. They did not complain, there's no food, but there was genuinely no food. Allahu Akbar. And he is the best. Like I said, the trees would have grown from his rooftop, from the sides, from anywhere and everywhere. Fruit would have come from the corners of the world. If fruit could have come to Maryam alayhi salatu was salam in that mihrab, what do you think would have come to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Absolutely everything. But no, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose in order for us to learn from that example that this world is not only about eating and drinking. There is far more to that. What is the legacy you are going to leave? They have left it. Today their names are such that when we start our lectures, we start off by saying, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all those who have struggled and strove through the years in a way that the deen came to me and you today. What are you leaving behind, my brother and my sister? What legacy are you leaving behind, my brother and my sister? If you were to go right here and right now, or on your way out of this masjid or anywhere else, if you were to leave tonight, what will you be remembered for? That is question number one. What will you be remembered for? What will your children remember you for? What will your companions, your spouse remember you for? What will your community remember you for? That is question number one. Question number two, if you were to die today, what is the main feature of your life that you are going to take and present in front of Allah tomorrow? Ask yourself, was it an adulterous relation you took on for 15 years? Is that the main feature of your life? And you carried on? So now when you come on Qiyamah, you are going to be presented with the highlights of your life to start with, then the details. When you come with your highlights, what's the highlights? I need to be ashamed. Their highlight would be, ya Allah, we have sacrificed our lives for you. That's the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. You will see it from the color and the scent. Because the hadith says the color will be the red color of blood and the scent will be the scent of musk. And with us, what will we come with? Wallahi, I don't even want to go into the beginning of what might happen. Wallahi, but it's important to mention one or two points because of the crises we are facing in today's world. Some of us might just present a mobile phone. That might be the highlights of your life. Me and my mobile. That's what it is. The S4. I don't know if you've seen it already. See, everyone's looking at me. Don't worry, it hasn't come out. I was just trying to see what people are going to look at me like. MashaAllah. S4, not yet. That means we're following the latest. May Allah make our phones the means of our entry into paradise rather than the means of our throwing into the hellfire. Wallahi. We can really make amends. We can really correct ourselves. Believe me. But if that's the highlight of your life, whole day, mobile phone. Whole night, mobile phone. Your husband wants to call you, he needs to tweet you or message you, and yet you're right next to him. It's happening. Wallahi. Don't worry, I use the reverse example. We've been saying wife for so long. We've got to say husband as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala correct both of us, all of us. Sometimes today, and some people don't like to discuss this matter, but wallahi we are suffering as an ummah from this. Even people who purportedly or who outwardly may seem religious, wallahi we have a lot to correct, a lot. The issue of pornography sometimes might be the highlight of your life.
So you're presenting it on the day. If you were to die now, before you walk out, we would be so embarrassed for someone after our death to go through our phones that we would make a dua to say, Ya Allah, before we die, if I ever die, Ya Allah, let this password be so strong that nobody sees what I went through in my life. But you don't realize Allah doesn't need a password. Allah knows what you did. Subhanallah. The other day I was reading an article about iPhone. And they say that anyone with an iPhone, their entire data is stored somewhere in the US. Entire. While you're looking at your phone, there are images being taken of you. Everything. I don't know whether it's true or false, but it woke me up. It shook me. And I said, never again will I purchase a product from there. No ways. We don't want it. iPhone. I was oblivious of the fact that it came from the West. They say they have every detail of your movement, your name, your this, your address. Whatever you are worth, more than you know, they know. They've got images of you every time your phone was in front. For as long as you have internet connection, you are dead meat. It's a reality. And then I thought, okay, that article might not be true. Perhaps it might be far-fetched. Perhaps we're giving them the benefit of the doubt. But we are frightened when we read something of that nature, not realizing Allah's got more than that about you and me. Come on. And then we're not scared. We're not frightened. Allahu Akbar. May Allah open our doors. Like I said, you ask yourself, if you die today, what is the legacy you're going to leave? Number one. Number two, what is it you've taken to present tomorrow? Where did we get that from? Here's the verse.
Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu attaqullaha waltanzur nafsum ma qaddamat lighad. Wattaqullaha inna allaha khabirun.
Oh, you who believe, be conscious of the Almighty. Each one of you, look into what you have prepared for presentation tomorrow. And be conscious of Allah. He indeed knows what you are doing. He knows what you are doing. What have you prepared for tomorrow? What are your deeds? What are you going to hand in? May Allah open us and our doors. May He open our minds, our hearts. May He open our spirituality. May He help us to love one another. Remember, my brothers and sisters, when you see someone doing something wrong, that's your brother indeed. He's not your enemy. He's not your enemy. He's your brother in Islam. You correct him with love. Like when you see your child, you correct your child with love. He's not your enemy. He's your child. When you see your fellow Muslims, brothers and sisters doing something wrong, it shouldn't make you excited to say, right, now I've seen this guy doing something wrong. That's it. I'm broadcasting it. No. If you really have iman in your heart, you will call the brother, brother, I need to talk to you, and so on. And you try and help them with their weakness. They are not. If Allah has used you to guide someone, one person, wallahi, it is better for you than anything this dunya holds. I can tell you why. Today someone sent me a message asking me, what is the reward if Allah has used you to attract people to Islam in a way that they entered Islam through your effort? That's a gift of Allah. Like I said at the beginning, Allah does not need me or you for Islam to spread. But if He has done it, it's a bonus. Wallahi, it's a gift. May Allah use us and continue using us. So I told him, I said, every single good deed that that person does, his salah, his Quran, his fasting, his zakah, if he teaches other people, the reward of the other people and his children and his progeny, you will get the reward of all of that. It is the biggest sadaqah jariyah you could ever have had. Biggest. Because you have started a candle that will begin to light so many other candles. Imagine one person accepted Islam because of your effort. And you worked on them. They remained steadfast. They started reading salah. You're getting a full reward of that salah they are reading. Then their family accepted as a result of them. And they invited 10 other people. You are getting a reward of 11 people now. And each one of them, their children came on the deal. You're getting a reward of 1,000 people. And you've passed away already. You've passed away. And you are the reward continues until the day of Qiyamah. This is why we say the highest rank is that of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No matter what I do or you do in terms of goodness, he gets a full reward of everything in terms of goodness. But when I commit a sin or you, then he will not get the sin of it because he's already warned us about it. So that's the beauty. Someone was guided through you, their sins you don't hold. But their good deeds, you get a full reward.
And it's not decreased from his, but rather it's multiplied for everyone. So I hope and I pray these few words that I've uttered the last 45 minutes that we've spoken for, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and grant us ease. In fact, it's 54 minutes to be precise. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our doors. Really, my intention was to motivate myself to start with and then everyone else. Because every time I think of the fact that Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib radiallahu anhu was martyred because of me, so the deen came to me. And Mus'ab ibn Umayr radiallahu anhu was martyred so that the deen could come to me. And the Sahaba were ready to give their lives, they gave them. The 313 who took part in Badr, and the 1,000 who took part, or the 750, whatever the figure was, who took part in Uhud, and the others who took part in Khandaq, and various other battles, some of which I won't even know about. Those who gave their lives so that the deen came to me today, I must never ever let that sacrifice be wasted by not waking up for Fajr, by not dressing properly, by not throwing out Beyonce and those other dirty people's music from my car. Astaghfirullah. What are they doing? They're calling you to Jahannam, and yet there were people who died for you. Allahu Akbar. If that does not motivate me to throw out my music CDs, what is going to motivate me? If life was all about dancing and moving your backsides, wallahi, today we wouldn't be sitting here. But that is what some of our children think it is. And that is where some people are heading. Why? Because we are not trusted in our own homes, like I said at the beginning. So our children couldn't care less. Because they see what dad is doing. You two-timing mom, and mom, you two-timing dad. And this is what's going on. So you guys are two-timing. I'm a youngster of the new generation. I will four-time. This is what's going on. May Allah safeguard us. May Allah open our doors. Wallahi, we need to cry. We need to weep. We need to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Really, what is it that I am going to leave the dunya with? What's the legacy? Am I going to be, oh, the biggest customer of Revlon and Chanel and what have you in terms of makeup? Was that my life? Or will I be the biggest customer, for example, of this and that in terms of the dunya? And I was the one who couldn't even do without 20 different types of perfume on my dressing table? Is that what it was? Is that the highlight of your life? That's what makes you happy in the dunya? So Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَٰلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِّمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. The virtue and the mercy of Allah, those two are what you need to be thankful for. You need to be happy about. It is better than anything you can amass and gather. That's what the Quran says. It is better than anything you can gather and amass. The fadl of Allah and the rahmah of Allah. The day Allah's mercy is upon me and you, I can be happy and proud. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Brothers and sisters, it's about time we turn to Allah. We left these little habits that we sometimes cling on to, because wallahi, they are not worth it. There are people who have sacrificed so much. Today we read about their legacy. Tomorrow, when people talk about Islam, let us also be part and parcel of that picture of people who are actually spreading the deen, even if it means to our own children. And inshallah, we meet in Jannah by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah to bless us all. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah wa bihamdih. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك.